My guest today has had an impressive journey from hell to heaven on the sustainability route. He started his career karting and motor racing at Brands Hatch, and he is now founder and CEO of Planet Mark. A very warm welcome to Steve Malkin. Steve, thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
Steve, can you tell me what Planet Mark means? What is a Planet Mark accreditation?
It's a certification for organisations who are measuring and reducing carbon every single year relentlessly. So if you measure your carbon, reduce it, hit your targets, then we'll certify that by checking out your data, looking at the evidence which supports it, and then engaging your teams and help you communicate what you're achieving and what you're looking to do.
But motor racing is known around the world for being about as environmentally unfriendly as you can possibly get. And here you are running one of the most environmentally friendly businesses in the world. What happened?
The birth of my third boy, and I was running a marketing company at the time, and we were doing, you know, really interesting work around sort of sport and scuba diving. And, you know, I did have an epiphany, and I did wake up one night, and it was one of those classics, you know, it was 3 o'clock in the morning, and I became aware of issues that we were seeing, you know, around, you know, a wonderful planet. And I felt I could better use my time and what skills I've got to direct it into something which, you know, has a better impact.
We're in a world now where more and more people are sort of waking up and saying, hang on a minute, the planet needs us to change. I mean, I know you woke up at 3 in the morning, but was there something that had triggered that early morning wake up?
One of the jobs I had was to promote scuba diving for the British Alpaca Club. And a great way to promote scuba diving is actually to put people underwater, you know, with the right kit on. But as soon as you get underwater, and even if you're snorkeling or whatever, or just have a mask, you actually see a completely new life there. I'd had the opportunity to go and do that, see that, seeing coral reefs, which are abundant with life. That was beautiful. And those coral reefs, you know, are at threat. They're at threat for sun bleaching. They're at threat from the boats that were taking people like me to them and dragging their anchors across them. So there's all sorts of things going on that they needed protection. And I wanted those reefs to be there, at least for, you know, for future generations. So what can we do about it? And the challenge that we spoke about with you know, opportunity and businesses and great ideas is then they spark something in you that you can't let go. And for me, it was, you know, I can't let go of this, and I've probably realised this is my purpose.
Have you always wanted to do things where you have a need to change the world?
I think no, but I think that if you just do your little bit to make it a bit better as opposed to a bit worse is probably where most of the time I've been coming from.
I want to talk a little bit about Charles Tirrett, because we've been doing Planet Mark accreditation for the last 2 years. Yeah. You started this nearly, next year it'll be 10 years ago. And I feel like as a business, we have woken up to this possibly a little bit late. How many businesses went through your accreditation in year one?
30.
And how many did you get last year?
We were 400 or 500. It's been a slow burn. So, you know, I've been doing sustainability work since about 2006. The challenge in the space then and still, when you talk about sustainability to people, about, you know, people and the contribution to society, you talk about how important nature is to us, they love to talk about it. In organisations, we really, really focus on business. You know, the urgency, what do we do, taking action. So it can be a lot of tyre kicking, in the old sort of phrase, you know.
Yeah.
And what's happened recently is there's a recognition that all sorts of climate-related impacts are playing out. There's all sorts of issues around, you know, plastic, and that's not good enough. And businesses know that they can make a difference.
Yeah.
And they're coming to it thick and fast, and it's truly exciting. Actually.
It feels like the new generation or the younger generation is pushing the older generation to really make a difference. A lot of the momentum seems to be coming. I mean, my daughter gives me a hell of a hard time about what she says, why do you send out brochures? But we send out brochures that are not great for the environment. What do you think I should say to her?
Ask her what she would do.
She would stop sending brochures and risk the business going bust. Because she is an idealist. What would you do? Our aim at Charles Tirrett is to be carbon neutral, and we are well on that road. And I'm actually delighted to say that this year I think we've decided to offset our carbon, which is great. But can you just tell me a little bit, explain to me the difference between carbon neutral and this term net zero?
Carbon neutral is a really good staging post. So what you're doing is you're saying, right, as a company, we're measuring our carbon emissions in our business operations. We are also reducing our carbon. Yeah, and any carbon which is left, so you've reduced your carbon, any carbon which is left, we're going to offset that carbon into high quality carbon offset projects,
yeah,
right? Which are accredited and everything like that. So you're measuring, you're reducing, and this bit which is left, yeah, going to offset, yeah, it. So that's carbon neutral. Yeah. Great staging post to net zero. Now, the difference with net zero is that you say, right, we're measuring our carbon, yeah, but we're going to have to look beyond our close business operations and into our supply chain.
Yeah.
So what's likely to happen to that is that you look at all of your production, distribution, downstream distribution, sale, yeah, and end of life of all of your products. So your carbon footprint's probably gonna go from this to this.
Yeah.
The second thing with net zero is it's saying, all of this stuff, you've ultimately got to get down by a higher percentage than carbon neutral. And we're gonna break that down into two bits. Your business operations that you had already offset actually have got to get to 90% reduction. So you only offset 10% of your business operations for net zero, right? So that reduction, you've got to make it much, much harder, much more ambitious for net zero.
If there was one thing you could tell people to do, is it to turn the lights off? Is it to stop using straws? What is the one thing that would make a real difference to the planet?
Everything you do will make a difference, because we're all coming at this, so many of us are coming at this at the same time. So the idea of buying better is really important. Putting pressure on your politicians is going to be really important. And if you're an employee of an organisation and you care about this stuff, use your passion and your voice inside that organisation to say, hey, listen, I'm happy to volunteer for a role inside this organisation to help drive our sustainability programme. Because sure as leaders in that company will be saying, actually, we need to be doing something here together. Now, if the employees and the leaders join up, then great things can happen.
Do you find that young people are much more passionate about this than older people? And I'm thinking slightly cliched that older people are the leaders, which is actually not necessarily the case anymore. But young people seem to have a much better grasp of this, don't they?
I think that they do, but I also don't want to prejudice the older people here. Younger people are quite right and not and been brought up in a slightly different world to the one that we might have been brought up in. And they see the world differently. They're coming at it with great energy and a real sense of urgency and agency. And that is a massive driving force.
And are we coming together fast enough and making a difference fast enough to make sure that this planet is going to survive?
No, we're miles off that. We are at the point where we can make it less bad.
What does less bad look like?
Well, let's take, so if we're seeing biodiversity and ecosystem breakdown, if we're looking at the quality of the soil, it's about actually how are we going to feed people? Right, it's going to be looking at mass migration of people moving from places where you cannot possibly live to places where you can. That's going to set up all sorts of issues in terms of, geopolitical issues, conflict. So we need to be sharing these messages about you saying, do you know what? Since we've done this sort of program, we've never looked back. It's good for my business. Why wouldn't I do this stuff? That's the message we need to get out there. We can bang the drum, but like you, we need you to be saying that as well, so that everyone follows suit. Because
yeah,
as an environmentalist, I might say this, mightn't I, but as a business leader.
Yeah, no, absolutely. We should get out there and bang the drum more. Steve, I have some quick fire questions for you. What is your favourite cuisine?
Love Italian.
Good. Original.
It must be top of everybody's list,
no,
surely.
Japanese is top of everyone's list. Do you tend to cook from scratch or do you have delivered in?
Scratch, but I'm learning. So, having come out of a relationship, I'm now throwing myself into cooking.
Delivered in is not very carbon friendly, is it?
No, it's not. So it's better if we can be cooking from scratch. And I think that's a major motivator.
Mm. What book do you have beside your bed?
I think it's Reading Water by Tristan Gooley. It's about looking at water and what you can learn from that.
What should every man own? Well, what's the one thing every man should own?
I'm not going to go down a consumable route here, okay? And it's going to be, I think it's humility.
Oh, that's a very good one.
Yeah. we've got a lot to learn and do together to crack the issues of our time and create a thriving planet. And I think humility, empathy, compassion go a very, very long way to do that.
When your children grow up and they look back at our generation, what will they say about what we did for the environment?
I think that they're going to say, like an old school report will be, could do better. I really hope that they say, you know, we turned the tide.
I hope so too. Steve Malkin, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, Nick.
You've got cold hands.
Yours are colder.
For a planet that's getting warm, it's pretty cold.